Macmillan Audio presents Boneshaker by Cherie Priest. Read for you by Kate Redding and Will Wheaton.
In this age of invention, the science of arms has made great progress. In fact, the most remarkable inventions have been made since the prolonged wars of Europe in the early part of the century, and the short Italian campaign of France in 1859 served to illustrate how great a power the engines of destruction can exert. Thomas P. Kettle, History of the Great Rebellion, From Its Commencement to Its Close, giving an account of its origin, the secession of the Southern states, and the formation of the Confederate government, the concentration of the military and financial resources of the federal government, the development of its vast power, the raising, organizing, and equipping of the contending armies and navies, lucid, vivid, and accurate descriptions of battles and bombardments, sieges and surrender of forts, captured batteries, etc., etc. The immense financial resources and comprehensive measures of the government, the enthusiasm and patriotic contributions of the people, together with sketches of the lives of all the eminent statesmen and military and naval commanders, with a full and complete index from official sources.
From Unlikely Episodes in Western History, Chapter 7, Seattle's Walled and Peculiar State. Work in Progress by Hale Quarter, 1880. Unpaved, uneven trails pretended to be roads. They tied the nation's coasts together, like laces holding a boot, binding it with crossed strings and crossed fingers. And over the great river, across the plains, between the mountain passes, the settlers pushed from east to west. They trickled over the Rockies in dribs and drabs, in wagons and coaches. Or this is how it began. In California, there were nuggets the size of walnuts lying on the ground, or so it was said, and truth travels slowly when rumors have wings of gold. The trickle of humanity became a magnificent flow. The glittering western shores swarmed with prospectors, pushing their luck and pushing their pans into the gravelly streams, praying for fortunes. In time, the earth grew crowded, and claims became more tenuous. Gold came out of the ground in dust so fine that the men who mined it could have inhaled it. In 1850, another rumor, winged and sparkling, came swiftly from the north. The Klondike, it said. Come and cut your way through the ice you find there. A fortune in gold awaits a determined enough man. The tide shifted and looked to the northern latitudes. This meant very, very good things for the last frontier stop before the Canadian border, a backwater mill town on Puget Sound called Seattle, after the native chief of the local tribes. The muddy village became a tiny empire nearly overnight, as explorers and prospectors paused to trade and stock up on supplies. While American legislators argued over whether or not to buy the Alaska Territory, Russia hedged its bets and considered its asking price. If the land were really pocked with gold deposits, the game would absolutely change. But even if a steady supply of gold could be located, could it be retrieved? A potential vein spotted intermittently but mostly buried beneath 100 feet of permanent ice would make for an ideal testing ground. In 1860, the Russians announced a contest offering a 100,000-ruble prize to the inventor who could produce or propose a machine that could mine through ice in search of gold. And in this way, a scientific arms race began, despite the budding Civil War. Across the Pacific Northwest, big machines and small machines were tinkered into existence. They were tricky affairs, designed to withstand bitter cold and tear through turf that was frozen diamond hard. They were powered by steam and coal, and lubricated with special solutions that protected their mechanisms from the elements. These machines were made for men to drive like stagecoaches or designed to dig on their own, controlled by clockwork and ingenious guiding devices. But none of them were rugged enough to tackle the buried vein, and the Russians were on the verge of selling the land to America for a relative pittance when a Seattle inventor approached them with plans for an amazing machine. It would be the greatest mining vehicle ever constructed, 50 feet long and fully mechanized, powered by compressed steam. It would boast three primary drilling and cutting heads, positioned at the front of the craft, and a system of spiral shoveling devices mounted along the back and sides would scoop the board through ice, rocks, or earth back out of the drilling path. Carefully weighted and meticulously reinforced, this machine could drill in an almost perfect vertical or horizontal path, depending on the whims of the man in the driver's seat. Its precision would be unprecedented, and its power would set the standard for all such devices to come. But it had not yet been built. The inventor, a man named Leviticus Blue, convinced the Russians to advance him a sum great enough to gather the parts and fund the labor on Dr. Blue's incredible bone-shaking drill engine. He asked for 6 months and promised a public test display. Leviticus Blue took his funding, returned to his home in Seattle, and began to build the remarkable machine in his basement. Piece by piece, he assembled his contraption out of sight of his fellow townsmen, and night by night, the sounds of mysterious tools and instruments startled the neighbors. But eventually, and well before the six-month deadline, the inventor declared his masterpiece complete. What happened next remains a subject of much debate. It might have been only an accident, after all, a terrible malfunction of equipment running amok. It may have been nothing more than confusion or bad timing or improper calculations. Or then again, it might have been a calculated move after all, plotted to bring down a city's core with unprecedented violence and mercenary greed. What motivated Dr. Blue may never be known. He was an avaricious man in his way, but no more so than most, and it's possible that he wished only to take the money and run, with a bit of extra cash in his pocket, to fund a larger escape. The inventor had recently married, as tongues did wag, to a bride some 25 years his junior, and there was much speculation that perhaps she had a hand in his decisions. Perhaps she urged his haste, or she wished herself married to a richer husband, or perhaps, as she long maintained, she knew nothing of anything. What is certain is this. On the afternoon of January 2, 1863, something appalling burst out from the basement and tore a trail of havoc from the house on Denny Hill to the central business district, and then came back home again. Few witnesses agree, and fewer still were granted a glimpse of the incredible bone-shaking drill engine. Its course took it under the earth and down the hills, gouging up the land beneath the luxurious homes of wealthy mariners and shipping magnates, under the muddy flats where sat the sprawling sawmill, and down along the corridors, cellars, and storage rooms of general stores, ladies' notions shops, apothecaries, and yes, the banks. All four of the major ones, where they were lined up in a row. All four of those banks were ravaged as their foundations were ground into mulch. Their walls rattled, buckled, and fell. Their floors collapsed downward in a V-shaped implosion as their bottom buttresses dropped away, and then the space was partially filled with the toppling roofs. And these four banks held $3 million or better between them, accumulated from the California miners cashing in their nuggets and heading north in search of more. Scores of innocent bystanders were killed indoors as they stood in line for deposits or withdrawals. Many more died outside on the street, crushed by the leaning, trembling walls as they gave up their mortar and crashed heavily down. Citizens clamored for safety, but where could it be found? The earth itself opened up and swallowed them, here and there where the drill engine's tunnel was too shallow to maintain even the thinnest crust of land. The quaking, rolling street flung itself like a rug being flapped before beaten clean. It moved hard from side to side and in waves. And wherever the machine had gone, there came the sounds of crumbling and boring from the underground passages left by its passing. To call the scene a disaster does it a terrific disservice. The final death toll was never fully calculated, for heaven only knew how many bodies might lie wedged in the rubble. And alas, there was no time for excavation. For after Dr. Blue lodged his machine back beneath his own home, and after the wails of the injured were tended, and the first of the angry questions were being shouted from the remaining rooftops, a second wave of horror would come to afflict the city. It was difficult for Seattle's residents to conclude that this second wave was unrelated to the first wave, but the details of their suspicions have never been explained to anyone's collective satisfaction. Only the observable facts can be recorded now, and perhaps in time, a future analyst may provide a better answer than can presently be guessed at. This much is known. In the aftermath of the drill engine's astonishing trail of destruction, a peculiar illness afflicted the reconstruction workers nearest the wreckage of the bank blocks. By all reports, this illness was eventually traced to the drill engine tunnels and to a gas which came from them. At first, this gas appeared odorless and colorless. But over time it built up to such an extent that it could be discerned by the human eye, if spied through a bit of polarized glass. Through trial and error, a few particulars of the gas were determined. It was a thick, slow-moving substance that killed by contamination, and it could be generally halted or stilted by simple barriers. Temporary stopgap measures cropped up across the city as an evacuation was organized. Tents were disassembled and treated with pitch in order to form makeshift walls. As these barriers failed one ring at a time, and as thousands more of the city's inhabitants fell fatally ill, sterner measures were called for. Hasty plans were drawn up and enacted, and within 1 year from the incident with Dr. Blue's incredible bone-shaking drill engine, the entire downtown area was surrounded by an immense brick, mortar, and stone wall. The wall stands approximately 200 feet high, depending on the city's diverse geographic constraints, and it averages a width of 15 to 20 feet. It wholly encircles the damaged blocks, containing an area of nearly 2 square miles. Truly, it was a marvel of engineering. However, within this wall, the city spoils. Utterly dead except for the rats and crows that are rumored to be there, the gas which still seeps from the ground ruins everything it touches. What once was a bustling metropolis is now a ghost town, surrounded by the surviving and resettled population. These people are fugitives from their hometown, and although many of them relocated north to Vancouver, or south to Tacoma or Portland, a significant number have stayed close to the wall. They live on the mudflats and up against the hills, in a sprawling non-town most often called the outskirts, and there they have begun their lives anew. 1. She saw him and she stopped a few feet from the staircase.
"I'm sorry," he said quickly. "I didn't mean to startle you."
The woman in the dull black overcoat didn't blink and didn't move.
"What do you want?"
He'd prepared a speech, but he couldn't remember it.
"To talk. To you. I want to talk to you."
Briar Wilkes closed her eyes hard. When she opened them again, she asked,
"Is it about Zeke? What's he done now?"
"No, no, it's not about him," he insisted.
"Ma'am, I was hoping we could talk about your father."
Her shoulders lost their stiff, defensive right angles, and she shook her head.
"That figures. I swear to God, all the men in my life, they...
She stopped herself, and then she said, "My father was a tyrant, and everyone he loved was afraid of him. Is that what you want to hear?" He held his position while she climbed the 11 crooked stairs that led the way to her home, and to him. When she reached the narrow porch, she asked, "Is it true?" "More true than not." She stood before him with her fingers wrapped around a ring of keys. The top of her head was level with his chin. Her keys were aimed at his waist, he thought, until he realized he was standing in front of the door. He shuffled out of her way. "How long have you been waiting for me?" she asked. He strongly considered lying, but she pinned him to the wall with her stare. "Several hours. I wanted to be here when you got home." The door clacked, clicked, and scooted inward. "I took an extra shift at the works. You could have come back later." "Please, ma'am. May I come inside?" She shrugged, but she didn't say no, and she didn't close him out in the cold, so he followed behind her, shutting the door and standing beside it, while Briar found a lamp and lit it. She carried the lamp to the fireplace, where the logs had burned down cold. Beside the mantel there was a poker and a set of bellows, and a flat iron basket with a cache of split logs. She jabbed the poker against the charred lumps and found a few live coals lingering at the bottom. With gentle encouragement, a handful of kindling, and two more lengths of wood, a slow flame caught and held. One arm at a time, Briar pried herself out of the overcoat and left it hanging on a peg. Without the coat, her body had a lean look to it, as if she worked too long and ate too little or too poorly. Her fingerless gloves and tall brown boots were caked with the filth of the plant, and she was wearing pants like a man. Her long dark hair was piled up and back, but two shifts of labor had picked it apart, and heavy strands had scattered, escaping the combs she'd used to hold it all aloft. She was 35, and she did not look a minute younger. In front of the growing, glowing fire, there was a large and ancient leather chair. Briar dropped herself into it. "Tell me, mister." "I'm sorry, you didn't say your name."
Hale Quarter, and I must say it's an honor to meet you."
For a moment, he thought she was going to laugh, but she didn't. She reached over to a small table beside the chair and retrieved a pouch. "All right, Hale Quarter, tell me, why did you wait outside so long in this bitter weather?" From within the pouch, she picked a small piece of paper and a large pinch of tobacco. She worked the two together until she had a cigarette, and she used the lamp's flame to coax the cigarette alight. He'd gotten this far by telling the truth, so he risked another confession.
"I came when I knew you wouldn't be home. Someone told me that if I knocked, you'd shoot through the peephole."
She nodded and pressed the back of her head against the leather.
"I've heard that story too. It doesn't keep nearly as many folks away as you might expect."
He couldn't tell if she was serious or if her response was a denial.
"Then I thank you double, for not shooting me and for letting me come inside."
"You're welcome."
May I take a seat? Would that be all right?"
"Suit yourself. But you won't be here long," she predicted.
"You don't want to talk?"
"I don't want to talk about Maynard, no. I don't have any answers about anything that happened to him. Nobody does. But you can ask whatever you want. And you can take your leave when I get tired of you, or when you get bored with all the ways I can say I don't know, whichever comes first."
Encouraged, he reached for a tall-backed wooden chair and dragged it forward, putting his body directly into her line of sight. His notebook folded open to reveal an unlined sheet with a few small words scribbled at the top. While he was getting situated, she asked him, "Why do you want to know about Maynard? Why now? He's been dead for 15 years. Nearly 16.
Why not now?"
Hale scanned his previous page of notes and settled down with his pencil hovering over the next blank section.
"But to answer you more directly, I'm writing a book."
"Another book?" she said, and it sounded sharp.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.